Hello and welcome to this episode of Mapping Faultlines, a show where we look at the major geopolitical issues across the world and their implications on the region. Today, we'll be talking about the situation in Syria, and we have with us Prabir Purkayastha. Hello, Prabir. Prabir, so as we know, US President Donald Trump announced that the ISIS leader Al-Baghdadi had been killed in Barisha, and there's been a lot of speculation about whether it actually happened because it's the fourth such report of his death. But taking for the moment his statement at face value, what do you see as the immediate implications of this death?
Well, let's first go over to this fourth time, hopefully lucky right. for the United States, that Al-Baghdadi has really been killed. It does not mean that the whole situation is going to change because one man dies. And as you can see, this is the Idlib sector, which the United States prevented Syria from going in, right. threatened them with airstrikes, various other things. The West has a huge campaign, particularly in the Western media, regarding this area. This is the last free zone of Syria, where apparently the freedom-loving people are there against the brutality of Assad's regime. All this campaign.
Right.
Now we find that Idlib is where Al-Baghdadi was holed up. It substantiates what we have always been told, that this is a place where all the different kinds of forces which have gone with the idea of regime change, aligned with the United States and earlier Turkey, mm-hmm. with the Gulf monarchies about regime change in Syria, now located. They are basically Al-Qaeda light or Al-Qaeda, or ISIS light or ISIS. Mm-hmm. And with the defeat, the fact that they have been squeezed into this area after successive defeats, this is the place where they have been evacuated to.
Right.
So this is what the West and Turkey have protected it now, and this is where Al-Baghdadi was also holed up. So I think that narrative, it also establishes what the correlation of forces are,
right.
even today in Idlib, and whether the Syrian government, with the support of the Russian, Iranian and other forces, will be able to clear this zone.
Right.
Because I think that's where the Syrians are really interested in. Mm-hmm. Because after all, more than the northern border, which also is of course something we need to discuss, or the eastern part of the desert, which also there are oil wells over there, but this is where the populated area is. Mm-hmm. Idlib is really the populated area.
Right.
And this is where the major communications between Aleppo, Damascus, all of it lie.
Right.
So Idlib clearing is very critical for Syria. Mm-hmm. And I think therefore it does substantiate what they have always been saying, that this is the haven at the moment for forces which are really different kind of Islamist extremists mm-hmm. who are located there. Let's not even call them Islamists. They're basically Islamic extremists or Islamic supremacists, if you will. This is the kind of forces which have been holed up. And we have to see that what is the West's attitude towards now Idlib. Mm-hmm. Now that there is substantiation, this is where Al-Baghdadi was also holed up, obviously under the protection of various forces.
Right.
Now, United States, as you know, does not really have any permanent enemies. Everything for it is transactional, support the ISIS to embarrass Syria, put pressure on the Iraqi government. That was what was done under Obama. And now under Trump, that policy has also become transactional, but differently transactional. Mm-hmm. So now what Trump will achieve in Syria, whether it will be for peace, which I doubt very much, whether it will be for transient advantage to embarrass Russia, or whether actually it says, well, we are overstretched, it's time we pulled back from the region and let the region solve its own problems.
Right.
That's something we still need to see.
So moving on to the northern border, as you said, so we have a situation, we have a highly uncertain situation right now. So there was the Turkey-Russia deal, which in some senses almost legitimizes Turkish control over portions of Syria. And while we have talked about this before, but what exactly does this imply for the Syria-Russia project of bringing the country back together under the government What exactly does it imply, considering that they themselves have given up bits of the country?
Well, I don't think they've given up bits of the country. Mm. They have accepted that Turkish forces at the moment will control some part of the territory, because they think, the Turkish forces or Turkey thinks, that this is on the border of Turkey and they don't want Kurdish control over that area.
Right.
And their argument has always been that the Kurdish forces are aligned to the PKK, which they regard as terrorist forces. So this is the whole narrative that is there. The question is that Syria is not in a position to fight the United States, the Islamists, extremists, and Turkey simultaneously.
Right.
So it has to prioritize what it wants to do right now. And for it, getting back the whole region from Aleppo to Idlib, that was one of the priorities.
Right.
Its second priority will be getting really the borders across Euphrates to Iraq. This whole area cleared of essentially the control from SDF, which, as you know, are Kurdish-led forces supported by the United States, to integrate that back into the Syrian government's control. So these would be its primary targets. One is the population, other is area. This is also where there is the Euphrates River flowing, so there are areas which produce grain and other things, but also the gas and oil.
Right.
Now, the gas and oil, as you know, Syria is not a major producer, but nevertheless, it would help Syria if it could recover this and use its revenue for reconstruction. At the moment, the United States posture or we have controlling the oil seems to be more of a spoiler, and also possibly for negotiating later with the Russians, with the Syrian government and so on. But it does seem that the way the whole accord has been worked out between Turkey and Russia, that while Turkey has been given certain role in the border, particularly between Kobani and Qamishli, the area which is really where they had the Rojava canton was supposedly located, which they don't accept, that they have been given some role. But how much of land they will occupy is not clear at the moment. The Astana Accord had said up to 5 kilometers. Now, the Adana Accord had said it's up to 5 kilometers. Now, that seems to be a very old agreement. I think it was 1997. So, what the reality of this area will emerge is not clear. At the moment, Kurds have been told to withdraw. The YPG has been told to withdraw 32 kilometers from the Turkish border, which means actually beyond the M4
highway.
So, M4, which is the main highway, at the moment, who's going to control it is not clear. From what it appears, Russian forces, along with Syrian forces and Turkey, would jointly control the area. So it's been left vague at the moment. Turkey has been using what it calls the Syrian National Army, which is really the old Free Syrian Army, which is what the Americans and others had all supported. Now we know from the Gray Zone report that 21 of the groups which were supported by the CIA and others are essentially a part of this forces, and they all essentially had Islamist antecedents. And as I said, when I'm using the word Islamist, I really mean the Islamist extremists, that they have those antecedents. So how this will pan out, whether it will be really the SNA controlling it, trying to resettle certain of their brethren over there, whether it will be Turkey that will control it, is at the moment not clear. So the hashed area that you have shown earlier, that area, it's uncertain.
Right.
What is at the moment clear is the Kobane area is being controlled by Syrian forces. So both Kobane and Manbij, it seems to be, is going to fall under Syrian and Russian forces supporting the YPG over there. And Hasaka to Qamishli, the other area in the east, that part of it, if you see there, you will see that those parts seem to be again under the Syrian government forces control. What's going to happen in this hashed portion in between, we're really not sure at this point. But I think Syria at the moment, its main focus is the eastern part and Idlib. And Idlib even more than the eastern part, because that's where the population really is.
Right.
And secondly, it will be the eastern part. And last part of it will be the northern part, where Turkey has made some inroads, put some favorites of theirs in control.
Right.
That, I think, is a card to be negotiated. It's a Turkey's holding some cards.
Right.
And that is the negotiation that will take place when this whole, shall we say, collective responsibility becomes norm. Mm. That collectively the region will work out its own problems. Right. Neither Russia or the United States would really do have any role. Mm. The Russians have always been saying they are really there only to facilitate this discussion. And they are not going to talk about their interest in this. This is something that the others have to negotiate. But the Americans have always been talking as if they're overseers.
Right.
And I think that's the distinction that we see between the Russian intervention in this case, as well as that of the United States. The very clear differences the way they look at it. And even today, when Mr. Trump talks about it, while it has this rhetoric about bringing people, boys back, but the boys are going to Iraq or going to Saudi Arabia, so we don't see them going home. But nevertheless, let's put it this way, not having decided to take on everybody in Syria, as the American establishment was talking about earlier, they will fight Turkey, they will fight Syrian government, they will fight Iranians, they will fight Russians. We don't know how many of them they will still continue to fight. But if they have at least withdrawn partially, I think there is a hope that the region as a whole will be able to negotiate with each other and try to reach a more durable peace.
Right. So, building on that a bit further, so we've established that Russia has sort of concretized its role as a major player in the region. And like you said, it's not been through a process of declaring its own interests as much as being a facilitator. And the US, on the other hand, especially over the past couple of weeks, has seemed quite at loss in this new situation. So, do you think that the recent attempts by Trump to, say, cozy up to the Turks might work and say sort of effect some sort of discussion between the Turks and the Kurds might actually have some impact, or is it likely to just fail?
Erdogan and Trump's attempt at Nobel Prize by trying to reach an agreement with the Kurds. You know, I think what people forget about the US foreign policy, the US foreign policy is entirely transactional. That means, who do I deal with today? While the Russians or any deep player, and that would also be, for instance, Brzezinski or Kissinger, while they had imperial interests of the US at heart, but they also had a geopolitical or geostrategic understanding of the globe. What has happened increasingly is that the US has lost that mooring, has lost that larger framework, has actually looked at each region at what does it help me to do A, B or C. Now, in that frame, the Russians seem to be playing a longer game. They're saying, look, Tatar sport is only one part. But how do I bring a situation where there is peace, the countries can talk among themselves, even if they are monarchy like Saudi Arabia to the Ba'ath leadership in Syria? How can they talk to each other? And how can we facilitate without grabbing anything for ourselves? Right. Except the bases we already have in any case. So that is the kind of relationship. They're not looking at it for bases. Mm-hmm. The US, as we know, has bases across the world. So, you know, US is the last one to talk about Russia having a base in Tartus. So I think given all of that, the transactional versus the geostrategic approach is, I think, what we see as the clearest indicator how this region is going and how the two major players, Russia and the United States, they still are the major military players. So China is the major economic player apart from the United States. I think what we see is that we are probably heading back towards a more geostrategic approach to issues, except for the United States, who still think that the world can be controlled transactionally and by the sheer fact that the United States can be a spoiler.
Right.
It can no longer set the terms of the engagement, but it certainly can act as a spoiler. And this ability of the US to spoil any effort for peace in Syria, we'll have to see whether that bears fruit. That's what they seem to be doing when you say trying to cozy up to Turkey. It's basically an attempt to see, can we give you something more? And therefore, can I spoil the kind of agreement Russia is seeking to establish between Syria and Turkey? I think that is more the role that in the US we have to observe. can this transactional role, can this spoiler role continue, and what its effect on the region will be? Because it's very clear to everybody that the US role is no longer being able to establish peace, or no longer able to establish a new equation between players. It's really one of trying to control A, B, or C, and also very, very short term at that. I think that's what is C. But I think that other net loser we haven't talked about is Israel.
All right.
The fact that Turkey, Syria, Russia, Iran, Iraq are all coming to some kind of an agreement would really mean that Israel's role, being able to bully one or the other country, make threats against any of the countries, is going to be increasingly difficult. The only place right now we have to watch is Lebanon, mm-hmm. which, as you know, is undergoing a number of street protests.
Right.
Nasrallah has appealed for peace to return, not to give demands which completely destabilize Lebanon's existing government, but try to extract within this framework a certain set of concessions. We have to see how that pans out, mm-hmm. whether the US is at the moment willing to sacrifice Lebanon so that they can get at Hezbollah. Is that the game? We'll have to see. So these are the further flashpoints, and
right.
we can see a similar thing in Iraq.
Iraq too.
So are they really the US playing spoiler, or is it really something which is more indigenous and more local? This is something we have yet to observe. And there is no question that the US is always willing to fish in troubled waters. And of course, Israel is very much a part of this fishing. So we'll have to see how this plays out again.
Thank you, Prabir. That's all we have time for today. Keep watching NewsClick.